A state sports agency could make an offer to buy Wrigley Field this week, but the Illinois Sports Facility Authority faces at least two hurdles if it wants to make over the historic ballpark. Tribune architecture critic Blair Kamin writes about this in today's paper and joins us from the Tribune Tower. So hurdle number one, landmark status. Hurdle number two, Mayor Daley, right?
That's right. And the mayor last week reiterated that the city does not want to relax landmark status, as the Tribune Company and the Illinois Sports Facilities Authority were suggesting.
The agency, headed by former Governor Jim Thompson, which already owns U.S. Cellular Field, may want to spend up to $400 million to give Wrigley Field a facelift. So let's start off by talking about what is protected.
Well, the protected features in Wrigley extend beyond the familiar red marquee at Clark and Addison and the outfield, the ivy-covered outfield walls. They really are the contours, the essential contours of the ballpark. So that's the exposed steel columns and beams that frame its exterior, its roof and roof lines, essentially then its height, and other features as well, like the part of the roof that faces toward the playing field.
But you write that the door is slightly open. Is that right? So there could be some changes?
That's right. Well, while all those essential features are protected, the landmark law is very clear in saying that city officials should consider the need to modernize the ballpark and adapt it in new ways. So, for example, the law also says that the seats and seating configuration are not covered by landmark status, nor are interior concourses, where the Cubs have already put up a lot of new signs. So, and the city makes the argument, which I find very convincing, that so far at least the Cubs and Tribune Company have been able to add to the ballpark within the confines of the landmark law. For instance, that was they're talking about the bleacher expansion of almost 1,800 seats that was finished in the year 2006. That project was very sensitively done, but it was guided along by the landmark process, which required a thorough review and ultimately resulted in something that looked like it had always been there from the time Wrigley was built all the way back in 1914.
You know, let's talk about that a little bit. For the diehard fan, a name change would be hard enough to swallow. Are there legitimate fears that Wrigley's charm would not be preserved?
Well, anytime there's economic pressures, they can tend to trump aesthetic ones. If the Cubs want to try to put in, like, two rows of skyboxes, for example, instead of the one that's there now, that might require jacking up the upper deck, which would not only increase the height of Wrigley, but also put fans on the upper deck further from the action than they are now. So those are real concerns. I mean, any time that there's money on the table, you know, if you don't have the landmark safeguards in place, Wrigley could be defaced. So these are, I think, you know, what the city and the mayor are doing in urging that landmark status be preserved rather than relaxed is actually very wise, because the landmark law does offer a balance between preservation and adaptation to new economic realities.
All right. Once again, Blair writes about this in today's Tribune. Blair Kamin, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.